All right. Thanks, everybody, for jumping on today. Really excited to chat with all of you just about hockey and what everyone's been up to, as well as, you know, what your roles are in hockey and broadcasting specifically. And, of course, data and analytics and how you use analytics in what you do and where you kind of see it going in broadcasting in general, but also, of course, in hockey. So, I'm sure a lot of hockey fans watching and know who you guys are, but if there's some more casual, you know, sports analytics fans watching, I thought we could get everyone to just let everybody know who they are, who they work for, what they do. I think we should start with the experience at the top with Mr. Craig Button. So, Craig, why don't you tee it off?
Okay, I'll start off with experience. And, you know, Bryce and Jamal, don't forget, I watched you guys play when you were in junior and in college. So, you know, I got a long history with you guys. Now, Ray and I are pretty close in age, so I can't say I watched Ray in junior, but that's okay. You know, I work with TSN. I do a little bit of work with NBC. I've worked with the NHL Network in the past. And, you know, as the game evolves and, you know, how we talk about the game and what interests people in the game evolves as well. And, you know, how we evaluate the game, not just the situations in the game, but the players in the game and try to attach value to it. I mean, those are all things with the salary cap that are all significant in terms of what people are interested in and certainly what interests us. You know, we're always trying to point out different areas of the game that capture our eye, but there's so many different perspectives. And, you know, what I always look for, not just for me, but what I'm listening is those unique perspectives. And everybody looks at the game and comes at it from a different perspective and offers you insight and information that I think can just enlighten all of us. And so that's what I try to look to do. And I try to emulate other people that do it really well, not just in hockey, but just in other sports.
I'm Ray Ferraro, and I too work at TSN, and I played 18 years in the NHL before I retired. And I retired in May, actually, of 2002 as a teammate of Jamal and Bryce in St. Louis. And so I retired in May, and in September I started broadcasting. I'm a game analyst. I do some studio work, but basically I do 100 games a year thereabouts. And I view what I do as, so I need to see what's going on in the game and I need to react to it almost immediately with an analysis of what happened. I don't think it's my job to say, look, the puck's here and watch it go behind the net and then watch it go to the point. I mean, you're all watching. I mean, that's what the TV is for. So my job's to say why something happened. And look, it's a fun gig. It's fun to do. I think we should have fun with it. I think we should project onto the viewer, hey, if something funny happens in the game, I want to talk about it. I love what I do, and I've been really lucky to do it. This, whenever the next season starts, will be my 19th year of broadcasting.
So I don't know who's up next. I'm thinking it's between Bryce and Jamal here.
I'll jump in. Yeah, I'm Jamal Mayers. I played for 15 years and retired in 2013 and worked with you, Mike, at NHL Network when it used to be in Toronto. And now I'm an analyst for NBC Sports Chicago for the Blackhawks doing their pre- and post-game show. My strategy or style, I guess, if you will, and analyzing is really to point out nuance. And I got some great advice early on is that some of the things that guys who've played or have experience having been around the game for a long time, notice tiny little things that maybe the viewer, casual viewer, wouldn't see. And so I think it's incumbent upon me to point those things out, not to overlook those things, to try, as Ray said, to make it entertaining and interesting as well. And it's been a fun journey. I've been doing it now for 7 years, and every year is different. Every year is exciting. As Craig mentioned, the game evolves and changes. And with that, being unafraid of the numbers and diving into some of that and understanding tendencies and things of that nature, I like to lean on my hockey background in seeing things and then allowing the analytics to support what I'm seeing, or perhaps there's a trend happening. And I've really found it a valuable tool in leading on both of those things. And it's been fun bringing in another perspective. And, you know, if we can make it enjoyable, make it entertaining, make it insightful, I like to say that a lot of these things in the game repeat themselves over and over. I try not to talk down to the viewer. Let them catch up, and over time, if they're new to the game, over time, these things continue to repeat themselves. It'll become part of their conversation, part of their education process, and make them more astute and understanding of what's happening in the game as they watch it.
I guess I'd be next. I'm Bryce Salvador, played 14 years, 7 with St. Louis, with Ray and Jamal, as they already talked about. And then I finished with 7 years in New Jersey, and retired in 2015. And to be honest, I didn't really think I was going to get into broadcasting. And what fell upon me was a role with MSG, being an in-game analyst between the benches, and then doing the pre- and post-game and intermission report for the New Jersey Devils. And so it's been a fun journey. And I think, like Jamal said, it's one of those things where, you know, I really learned pretty quick that the things that we take for granted from playing the game, a lot of people don't see that aspect. And simple things of just, you know, when the puck goes from below the goal line in the offensive zone up to the blue line, and when I was saying, you know, move the puck from low to high, you know, was, you know, really informative for a lot of the viewers in New Jersey. And then building upon that and just explaining, you know, what are some of the tendencies that are going to happen in the faceoff circle. You know, centers pretty much tie up the other center in almost every, you know, system, unless they're doing something, you know, unique. But just little things like that, pointing out those type of tendencies, it really started to see that fans really gravitated to. And we were fortunate, I know, Ray, at the end of your career, and Jamal at our career, that we started breaking down the game of our own games. We started getting the DVDs on the plane, and at first people were saying, "Sal, like, what are you doing? Why are you watching yourself play again?" You know, and I found that by doing that and having that experience of doing that really carried on to this, because as I was started to break down goals and stuff like that, I realized that there were a lot of people that didn't understand where the mistakes were happening. And so by just pointing that, hey, this guy got beat off the wall, you know, and highlighting that, and not necessarily why the guy was wide open in front of the net, you know, really also started to educate, you know, the viewers. And then kind of coming across you, Mike, and what Sportlogiq was doing helped me add some context around some of the general sayings, like, "Oh, man, this goalie gives up a lot of rebounds." Well, it was nice to say, well, you know, if whether it be, you know, Washington would say, you know, their goaltending, you know, they gave up the most rebounds in the league, and that the Devils need to understand that. And so stuff that we all say many times during the game, it was nice to actually put some stats behind that to reinforce, you know, what I was saying. So it's been a great journey so far.
And I'm Kyle Bukauskas. I've been with Sportsnet for about 7 years now, initially just as a reporter, but over the last few years I've had the opportunity to work as a ringside host on Saturday nights and some other midweek games as well. And for myself, I mean, I'll never come at it from a player's perspective or an executive perspective, because I'll never be able to see and understand and process the game in that way. My niche more so is storytelling and finding different ways, whether it's, you know, little anecdotes, tidbits, it's entertaining, interesting, what have you, any way I can to try to tie in what's unfolding in front of us over the course of the game. And over the last few years recently, the ability to tie in some analytics when it makes sense for me. And of course, that's a big reason why we're all here today.
Awesome. And I've been watching your videos you've been putting on Twitter, Kyle, during this isolation period, and you could be an actor, man. Don't sell yourself short. That's there's some funny stuff you're putting out there.
Appreciate that, but I'm not going to quit my day job, Mike.
Fair enough. You're pretty good at your day job, so that's all good.
Well, you know, it's, Mike, if I could just interject, yeah. And just, you know, it's interesting just when Kyle finishes, right? And like, you know, for Ray and Jamal and for Bryce, you know, when I always tell players, take the viewer to some place they've never been. You know, you've been down on the ice, you've been there, and you know, those moments of that all arise that you can take them. I mean, people talk about hockey and they know hockey, but to go right there in the heat of the action, and now you add these other parts, like, you know, the storytelling, the funny parts, the anecdotes, and then the analytics. I mean, it just rounds out so much and makes you so good. I'm a huge Chris Collinsworth fan. Huge Chris Collinsworth fan. So when I talk about learning from others, you know, he played, he's got an analytics company, he can tell stories. And so I think that, you know, you three are all really good examples of not bringing only your experiences of playing into it, but also you want to add all these other elements. And I think that the future of broadcasting with that type of an example is great. So.
Yeah, and, you know, one of the reasons I asked all of you to be on here is because you do incorporate a lot of different elements into what you do, and you have different roles, whether it's studio analysis or rinkside reporting, in-game analysis. You all do a really good job of that, and, you know, I'm Mike Kelly. I work as a director of media and content at Sportlogiq and as an analyst with the NHL Network, and what's a little bit different about me, I guess, than you guys is that I come at data and analytics as a primary source of analysis, because that's the background and the experience that I have, where all of you have different backgrounds and experiences and have come to use this information as another tool on top of that. So, you know, I like what you said, Kyle and Craig as well, about the storytelling when it comes to analytics. Like, one thing I think about a lot that I try to remember is give the viewer what they want, but in a way they don't expect it. And, you know, if there's a big storyline going into a game or in a game, that's it. That's what everyone's going to be talking about. But how can you approach that with a unique vantage point? Analytics obviously is a way to do it. So for me, because my background's different and I use that as the primary tool, and then I talk to people like yourselves to try to get different viewpoints in rounding something out, I'm interested to hear from you guys how you take, you know, this information, which maybe a lot of people at home aren't as familiar with, and weave it into what you do on the air with things like time constraints where you can't explain everything. I mean, Ray, you touched on that. How have you guys managed to take this kind of complex information, but get it in kind of a natural way? Why don't we start with you, Jamal?
Yeah. Well, for me, a lot of what I'm doing in the pre and post game show, the work is done the prior game. So in essence, it's really preparation for the pregame for myself. So the previous game, I'm usually taking notes of what's happening. And let's say it's a bad power play, or it could be poor defending in the offensive zone, not doing a good job of, or allowing way too many odd man rushes. Let's say those are the three things that tend to happen. Whatever one actually item becomes the story on that given night, that's what I'll talk about in the next pregame. And having the ability to use analytics to support those examples has been unbelievably valuable. And you know this, Mike, I've leaned on you heavily in those occasions of saying, okay, listen, this is what's happening. It appears as though the Hawks are allowing way too many rush chances. You're then able to go in and give me the data to support that. And then I'm able to, convey that message to the viewer in the form of a chart or in the form of some type of visual so that they can then make it part of their understanding of the game. And then they could possibly look to see if that's a tendency that's going to continue. I think it's been unbelievably valuable for myself to have that ability to communicate that, to see it as a hockey person, but also have the support analytically to say, this is actually what's happening and these are the numbers to support it. And it's been a fun journey because, as you know, certain things happening within a game or within a block of games, and because I'm mainly concentrating on one team, I'm able to follow those trends as the season goes along and point those out to the viewer. And I think it's added a lot of value to my analysis and substance, not being afraid of the numbers and being able to talk about the analytics. And I think it's been invaluable as I've grown as an analyst.
See, Jam, so like something I do or have to do a little different is, as Mike mentioned, I've got that time constraint. And so like in game, I can't do something as detailed as perhaps I might like, because the puck's on the ice too quick and I got to shut up because the play-by-play guys got to get going. So what Mike's been able to do, and I really think this is the future of analytics in game, is that he's been able to put an analytic package together for me inside of 7 to 10 seconds. And something that comes up on the board, for example, there was a time this year Freddie Anderson from the Leafs was getting beat up over top of his glove quite frequently, and everybody knew it and everybody was talking about it. Mike was able to put a package together of number of goals given up over the glove, through the legs, low blocker, and put it in context of what's happening to other goalies around the league. So we can show a goal that beat him, and we have this built prior to the game. In the truck, they update it immediately that says 17 goals over the glove, for example. And so we show the goal, and then the Sportlogiq analytic package comes up, and it comes up for 5 or 7 seconds. I talk over top of it, and I can add depth and context as opposed to just saying, hey, everybody's beating Anderson over the glove. Now, it could be Freddie Anderson or anybody else, but if I don't have a number to go with it, then I can only go so deeply with it. And if it's too complicated and too mathy, I don't even know if that's a word, but if it's too mathy, people aren't going to get into it, because they come home, they want to watch the game, they want to learn it a little deeper. And that's part of our jobs, to show what we know or what we experienced, and talk about why the job is hard, like why the game is hard, why that spinning puck created a problem for a guy. That's one thing. But if you can back something up with factual analytical data and do it quickly in game, I think that's the future. I think that's the way the games will continually to be presented. The player tracking that's going to come in is going to help even more so, because we're going to end up with more information, more available, more quickly that we can get to the viewer. And for me, it's been really fun. Because I sent Mike a note, I don't know, earlier this year, whenever earlier this year was, and it's almost like the animation is almost fun to look at. Mm-hmm. And I think that's really important too, is the detail, if it's fun to look at, and then you go, oh, I get that. That makes sense. We see it in football all the time. We see baseball's built for analytics, but mm-hmm. Hockey, that we're finding our way, but I think we're really finding our way into the process of getting it in game, as opposed to what you might do between periods when you can build a bigger, thicker package.
And it would be trends too, Ray, like as the game is unfolding. I know the one thing we've really tried to focus on this year and working with you guys, Mike, at Sportlogiq, the ability to, you know, slide into your DMs, if you will, if we notice anything that's unfolding over the course of a game where, you know, through two periods, and this is more would be for like Jim Houston and Craig Simpson, if they're going like, geez, the Leafs are getting hammered in front of the net tonight. And then it's, hey, what are the numbers through 40 minutes? And well, of the 46 shot attempts they've given up, 32 of them have come from the inner slot, and they've already given up 2 goals from that spot too. And then to set up your third period, you've got that little bit of information real time to say, this is a big reason why they're chasing by a couple of goals through two periods so far tonight. So the ability to go into a game with a couple of different things, and then also to react to what you're seeing almost real time, and to get data and information almost not instantaneously, but relatively quick, certainly when you have an intermission to come up with some things. That's a huge asset too, to try to tell the story as the game's unfolding.
Yeah. And, you know, just kind of tying into it, you know, a little bit of everyone's conversation here, my role is a little bit unique. I see you, Ray, at some games in between the benches. My pregame, I can do a lot of that the night before, but I'm breaking down all the goals in between the periods, and you know, the Sportlogiq package will send me, you know, how many shots each guy's taking, breakout passes, who's making different reads, zone time. And so as I'm running up to the booth to, you know, try to break down the goals, I can get some real live data that might be applicable to some of the situations that are happening, you know, for the results of some of the goals. But, and so it's been very helpful. But the whole reason for me to honestly use analytics, at least to start when I started a couple of years ago, was in the purest sense, was I was the captain of a lot of those guys on the team. And if I was going to start critiquing them, and call, you know, and pointing out, you know, situations that, you know, that are going to expose them, I wanted to make sure that I was, you know, using reliable, you know, facts and data, and just because I've been there. And, you know, and sometimes the stats don't look good for you, but you know, you can point out that, well, you know what, it's, you know, the Devils are not doing a very good job in the neutral zone or the offensive zone. Their forecheck, you know, is, you know, ranked 30th in the National Hockey League, which then puts a lot of pressure on the gaps for the defensemen. And so while a defenseman on the Devils may have been exposed, I can also tie in the offense now by saying, hey, they didn't do a good job on the forecheck. So that's, you know, how I really started using and why I wanted to start using it. But it was a big process, and I, you know, I've been really fortunate with MSG to give me the flexibility in the, and really the runway to say, hey, you know what, I want to talk about shot attempts, I want to talk about inner slot, and but not lose the fan in the process. And so but yeah, that's the main reason why I started using analytics, was so I could still walk into the dress room after the game and the guys wanted to talk to me.
Sal, I was laughing because you're like, you know, you can talk about the gap and you can tie it to the forwards. Still the same, eh, Jam? Defense playing on the forwards. We're just doing our thing up there, and you guys are, you know, like, just put it on our stick, would you? We can break out. You're like, well, why don't you come back where I can see you? Still safe.
Well, you know, Bryce, you know, when you talk about that too, like, you know, like we get into these positions and we have to provide perspective and at times analysis that can be critical. But, you know, as long as it's fair and it's balanced, and to your point that it's backed up with really significant, reliable data, then you're not just kind of picking and choosing and, you know, oh, can you believe what he said? He doesn't like me. And I think that those are not just factors that are important when you're doing it. They're factors for the fans and for the players, as you point out. Nobody wants to be, you know, unfairly criticized. And Kyle, back to what you said, you know, reacting in the moment, right? Like, you know, you think about how much work you do to prepare for a broadcast. Well, that can all go out the window in the first period. So the ability to react. And I think that that's another thing when you, and Jamal, you talked about the preparation, right? Like we prepare and prepare and prepare. And a lot of the times the stuff we're preparing for, we might not even use that game. But if we're not prepared and we need it, we're going to feel naked there. And I know that all of us feel the same. There's nothing worse than feeling like you're exposed and you don't know. And I think that's where analytics and numbers help us go a lot deeper and a lot further in feeling confident about our abilities as well. So not only what we give, but also how we feel about ourselves.
Yeah. And I think, you know, what's great for me is being able to take the information that I look at and how I approach analyzing a game in game or before or after, and, you know, getting to where I need to be with that, but then being able to send a note to Ray or Bryce or Craig or Jamal, whoever, and say, hey, I noticed this with this team. This is what the data is telling me. I watched some videos. What I think I see, like, you guys have been on the ice, you guys have run teams. And you're able to add, okay, well, that's probably because of this, that, or the other thing. And it's kind of inverse with you guys and me, I guess. But all it is to me in the end is you're just trying to get a complete picture of something, right? Like I hear people talk about, I don't like analytics, or the viewers at home aren't going to like analytics. They don't want a math lesson. Or the other side, you know, saying there needs to be more analytics in broadcasts and it should be a bigger thing. And I really think that the perfect marriage is the infusion without anybody even knowing it's there is, you know what, you just got a piece of analysis that was driven by data and analytics and supported by video. And there might've been a number, one number attached to it maybe, but the viewer at home just says, huh, that's really interesting. And they don't feel like they've gotten any kind of analytics lesson. It's just naturally in there.
So that's a good point, because like, I know I've grown in my acceptance and understanding of analytics, because the initial analytics, not the initial analytics, but once that next wave came where it got more and more detailed, first of all, I didn't understand it. Secondly, as soon as I saw a bunch of graphs, I'm like, how am I going to use that in a game? Well, the point is you don't have to. What you've shown me and what I've learned from analytics is that, or from other people using analytics, is you can have a scenario. And Jam, you said this early on, that the same events repeat themselves over and over. Like, there's only so many things that can happen in a game, and they start to repeat themselves. But I don't have any way to say, hey, remember 2 games ago that that third forechecker lost his way and it broke out a 3-on-2 and Bryce's defenseman had to back up. And well, now I've got an analytic number to say the Blackhawks, the Bruins, the Blues, whoever, give up more man advantage breaks than anybody else in the league. They've given up over 4 a game. Most teams give up 2.5. I can actually give something analytically that doesn't even seem analytically, but it's an actual fact. It's a number. It's not just out of my eye. And so when you talk about the big picture, that's the first thing I think of, is that I had to understand that this isn't going to turn the way I analyze a game into all numbers, all detail, because I think there's still, I've got to point out things that are happening like right now, and I've got to get to it. But I can do it with an analytical support. And I never thought that was going to be possible. And I see it now, and I'm like, that is the way it's possible. You put analytics in to a broadcast, in a lot of cases, it doesn't even seem like they're there, but the numbers and the support are there.
It just seems like for a lot of circles still, like there's a stigma around analytics. They think Corsi and they think Fenwick. And of all the times that I've used analytic type stuff that you've helped provide at Sportlogiq, Mike, I don't think I've ever used those words. I mean, you think, especially doing a game on television, the visual aid is such a huge key to things, whether it's showing where goal locations are in an offensive zone. You know, Ray touched on with Freddie Anderson where goals are going in on him. There's so many other ways you can incorporate that data that, as you guys said, it doesn't seem like analytics. I know for us, I mean, it's another tool in the toolbox. We don't let just analytics and data guide us entirely in terms of how we tell the story of a game, but it's another asset for us where when it makes sense to incorporate, to help enhance the story and enhance a point that I'm trying to make, Jim's trying to make, Craig's trying to make, whoever it is, that's when I think it's at its biggest power.
Yeah, I did a game in February with you guys, Kyle, on Hockey Night in Canada, and you and I were up in the booth. And I think, you know, I got a little bit of a taste. You know, previously in my career, I spent a year doing color commentary for the Laval Rocket radio, and got a kind of a taste about, you know, as Ray talks about, the feel of a game and jumping in and getting out at the right times and how quick it really is. I mean, it's fast. It's you might think it's fast, but when you do it, you realize how fast it is. And, you know, Kyle, if they're throwing to you between whistles and you've got an update, you know, it really goes quick. So you have to succinctly get a point across, which again becomes more difficult as the information becomes more complex. So if you're able to simplify it, it's that quote, right? If you can't explain it simply, you probably don't understand it well enough, right? So it's got to be really simple. But when we did the Hockey Night in Canada broadcast in February in Montreal, being up in the booth with you and then, you know, Shirali, a great producer that you guys have, he does such a great job of understanding, okay, I think it can support here. Let's go here. No, this isn't the right time in the game for something like that because it's a different kind of feel to it. So kind of navigating that as well is good, but yeah, being able to, you know, I think we were talking about Philip Deneau and what a great defensive forward he is, which is, you know, something that's starting to come to light, I think, a little bit more and more, nationally and across the league. But being able to get a data point out about just how good defensively Philip Deneau is, and do it in a short period of time. It's it takes a little bit, I think, but I think at the end it does give more to the viewer if they're able to say, okay, well, you know, I've heard that and I kind of know that, but wow, he's first at that thing, or that's what really helps drive his success. I think hockey fans are smart. You know, I think that they're capable of handling that type of analysis and information. So, you know, I'd be interested to hear from you guys as well.
Can I just add one little thing that, Mike, too? Like, and it goes back to what Jamal, Bryce, and Ray, and Kyle said. You know, in the game, there's repeatable events. And if we extrapolate from there, you know, those repeatable events are by the best players, right? So, and we always have a focus on the best players, too. So
the worst players.
Yeah. Yeah, but you never see that on the marquee about, like, tonight, tune in tonight for the watch the fourth line winger, unless his name is John Scott at the All-Star game. But all kidding aside, you know, but, like, you know, when you can put it in the context, like, you know, here's what Patrick Kane is doing, you know, here's what you know, PK Subban is doing, Ray, I mean, we do the games, Kyle, and then you put it in context of those top players, like, let me tell you how good he is. Here's where he ranks amongst these players. And, you know, that ability too really helps tell a story within the game too, because ultimately those best players are repeating those high-end events more often than the other players.
Yeah, and Jammer, you'll know this obviously from watching Pat Kane and knowing him and all that, but, you know, that's a guy, you look at the last few years, who scores from the high slot more than anybody in the league. And he's got a sneaky, sneaky good shot, right? I mean, you think best shot in the league. I don't know that he's a guy that comes right to the top of people's minds, because you think maybe Ovechkin and Stamkos and these kind of guys, Matthews. But Patty Kane's got that deceptive, good release, you know, good shot. So that's a repeatable event, obviously. If he's a guy that scores from this area the most, it's likely to happen more than anybody else. So if you've got that information in your back pocket, you wait for it, it happens, and you're able to say, hey, this guy's the best at doing this thing, which I think, again, is a very simple thing to get across. It's not a math lesson, right?
No, and it also, to be honest with you, it's something that he wasn't even aware of. I remember when we talked about that, and I texted him that data, and he's like, I got to shoot the puck more, because he wasn't aware that he scores from distance, and you're right. And it's no disrespect to him. He doesn't have a blazing shot. He started to realize, okay, what is it unique? What's unique about his ability to get those pucks through? And that's just the point. Upon further analysis, I realized that he does a great job of shooting through people. He does an unbelievable job of waiting when the precise moment, perhaps there's a moving screen, whether it's the goalie's own defenseman or his teammate. He's picking a spot from a certain area that he knows the goalie's not going to be able to see the shot. And it's really genius to watch him do it and see him do it over and over again. But you're absolutely right, Mike. I would not have known that if you hadn't brought that to the forefront. And, you know, that was a real nice nugget for fans to chew on, to say, you know what, I'm going to look for that. Apparently, you know, Kaner is the best in the entire league at shooting from distance. That's something, I mean, we all know how great a passer is, and he's able to create, he's good on the shootout and all these other things, but having that analysis and the support analytically really allows the viewer, allows me to convey that message, and it's invaluable. I'll even point to another example. I think several years ago, I had played for San Jose, and I told you about Joel Pavelski, and I said, I don't know what it is about this guy, but I've never seen anybody tip more pucks. And you went in and did a thing and said, actually, he took 58 pucks more than the second guy last year. And then I started to think, well, what makes him special? Why is he able to do that? And then I started to think, most guys just stand in front of the net. Well, what Joe does is he takes a linear path, whatever that straight line is from his defenseman shooting the puck. If he has to stand 20 feet away from the goal, he'll stand 20 feet away and tip it from there. He finds that line wherever it is. But if there was an analysis to figure out why that was happening, to take an even deeper look into it, I would never have figured out why that happens or why he's so skilled at that. And I think what it does, quite honestly, I think even the next level, is other players are going to start to analyze what makes other players successful. And they're going to try to make that part of their game. And I think diving into this, you'll see even players take this information and want to take it a step further, either to implement it to their own games or even understand why they're able to get beat by these special players.
Hey, Jamal, yeah. You said something there that tweaked me again here. This is really cool to listen to what you guys are saying. But so as you're doing your analysis, like, and you're saying, you know, you dug into Patty and how he shoots the puck through people and finds that little lane. It's also, you're able to describe why none of us could do that. Like his patience with it, right? Like he could wait and hang on and we'd all go, holy crap, it's getting really crowded here. I better get rid of the puck. Or when he comes up and skates up by the blue line, man, I never wanted the puck up there. Like I'm 5 feet from disaster. If I turn it over, it's a breakaway. And he holds it and you can describe that.
Imagine how I felt.
Yeah.
But that's where our player experience marries with all this analytics. You can analyze it and put it together and say, look, he gets the puck through better than anyone else. Here are the numbers. The reason he can do this is he can see better than most. He can hold it better than most. His skill set, his quick release is better than most. And for guys that are going to, they're going to look at it and try and emulate it. Some guys will be able to, and other guys won't. And that's why Patrick Kane is among the very best players. That's one of the reasons he's among the very best players in the league.
Yeah. And you talk about your experiences, Ray, and I mean, and that is so important to be able to take again, like, oh, there's no way I could do that. And to Bryce, you know, you can talk about Ray. Yeah, when he came up 5 feet inside the blue line, I had to back way out because I was afraid there was going to be a breakaway, right? Back to those damn forwards leaving you high and dropping.
No,
but also in your analysis, right? Like, you know, there's also the flip side of it, right? Like, so Bryce, you're doing a game for New Jersey against Chicago, and you can point out to the fan, hey, they better be aware of Patrick Kane up here. Like, so it's information that you can use both ways, right? In terms of understanding the numbers and where it all fits into to draw the viewer's eyes to something that potentially could and does happen.
Yeah, so that's a prime example. And Mike and Jamal, I don't know if you guys went any further with that, but chances I would assume would be that Patrick Kane, like, he probably has one of the highest zone entries into the offensive zone. Like he's probably
puck,
yeah, right. And so what I would do is from the defensive perspective, I'd say, hey, the Devils better have defensive backside pressure and don't let him cut to the middle. You got to keep him to the outside, right? And so if not, you're going to see he's going to have puck possession. And so that's, you know, how I would flip it around. So you're exactly right, Craig.
Well, I'll just take you back into the locker room when you had coaches that gave you a game plan. And as players, you're going, this isn't going to work. You know, despite the best, you know, objectives of the coaches, right? You guys knew, right? Well, it's the same thing now with analytics and offering that to the fans. There's certain things where, you know, you're convincing the fans. The coaches have to convince you, too, that, like, what their game plan was going to work. And I think that's where analytics comes in, too, to show the fan and give them another perspective, as you point out, Mike, kind of completing the picture.
Yeah, and I'll just touch on what Jamal was saying about Joe Pavelski. This was an interesting tie in there, and you talked about Jammer, how, you know, maybe other players are seeing that and trying to emulate. I remember talking to Gabe Landeskog at the All-Star game in San Jose last year, and he was almost at 30 goals at that point. He'd never scored 30 before, and I, you know, we get to talking, and we had talked before that as well, just about, you know, what he tries to do in the offseason to get better, et cetera. And he said that off season before the season started, he wanted to work on his deflections. He wanted to get above 30 goals for the first time. And he knew, well, I can't turn into a zone entry guy like Pat Kane. I can't blow by guys like Connor McDavid. I have to play within my own game, but how can I add to that? And he's a net front guy and he can play that. So he talked about how he watched Anders Lee and he watched Joe Pavelski and saw how they did things the same way you described. How you did to understand how Joe would be as successful as he was. And you know, really intricate stuff. Like Gabe's talking about how he, you know, a lot of times guys will go to the net and they'll present their sticks for a defenseman. But, you know, he wouldn't do that because it's easier to get tied up. So
he'd kind of keep his stick in front of him and then react to the shot when it came. All these little details. And sure enough, he led the league in deflection goals that year, scored 30 for the first time. So that's somebody who watched a guy, took some information, you know, got better in his own game. I'm curious with you guys as well. Is there anything that you maybe didn't know or didn't know to the extent that you know now about the game, about tendencies, about pattern recognition, that analytics has kind of helped you say, oh, you know what, I didn't know this was maybe this significant, or I didn't know that this was, whether it's, you know, with a team or with a player or the game as a whole, is there anything that analytics has kind of opened your eyes to that's made you look at the game a little bit differently?
I'll start, I guess. For me, it's the number of goals that are scored when the pass goes across the middle of the ice in the offensive zone. I think we all talked about it, that, you know, the puck's got to go side to side. If you come, I talk about it on a 2-on-1 for years, that if a forward carries the puck from the center red line in and never passes it, the goalie never has to move. He comes out, he establishes his angle, and he just stands there. It's easy for him, easier for the goalie to make that save. As soon as the puck goes across the ice once, like, you know, through that middle zone of the ice, in the offensive zone, the goalie's got to move. He's got to reestablish his position. He might only be off by a couple of inches. That might be the only thing you need. But the number of goals that have been proven to be scored when the puck goes from, say, the left side of the ice to the right side of the ice and shot from that position, that really surprised me. Maybe I knew it kind of as an abstract, but seeing the numbers of it, I didn't know that.
What about you, Kyle?
Man, so much. I mean, it's just great. Again, not coming from a player's background or working for a team, like, all of this is just such good information for myself. And I know, like the insights you would send out to us the night before or the morning of a game, and the way you explained it, I mean, it was good for me to kind of go, oh, okay, now I understand. But certainly, I mean, I guess this seems obvious, but actually being able to look at graphs and to see where goal locations are coming from on the ice, whether it's a team as a whole or a specific player where he does most of his damage for him. And it's just good, again, visually to be able to see that and understand, okay, that makes sense. That's why Austin Matthews continues to go to the left side, or that's why his one-timer has been much more effective this year, because look where the goals are going in, and little things, or even stuff that surprises you. I remember we had a conversation about William Nylander, the amount of goals from the inner slot, and you don't necessarily think of someone like him as a net front type guy, and the conversation and the information you showed me about how just even this year, the average height and size of players that scored the most from that era of the ice versus 5 or 6 years ago, they're a lot smaller now because of, I guess, the less punishment they take in front of the net and their ability to just know and to arrive at the exact perfect moment when the puck gets there, and they're not spending a lot of time in front of the net. Little things like that, that again, without the added help and data of different types of analytics. I know for myself, again, who doesn't process the game and anywhere to the high level as the rest of the gentlemen on this call, I mean, it just has been a big help for me for trying to better learn about, you know, where the goals do in fact come from.
And what's interesting for me is, and I, you know, talk about this lots, there's not one way to win. There's many different ways to win. And your team is built in a certain way. I'm going to use a Ray Ferraro line. You know, a team wins the Stanley Cup and everybody says, oh, they got to go change your team and play like that. And he's always said, it's not like a gazebo in your backyard that you tear down and just go build a new one. Your players are in place. And so to understand, you know, what type of team you have, what type of players you have, and trying to maximize their abilities and not get them all kind of shoehorned into one style of game and say, no, this is what you're good at. This is what we're going to be good at and go after it. Mike, you and I were talking about Travis Green and the Vancouver Canucks. And, you know, they're not a very good team, you know, in their defensive zone. But Travis says, okay, that's what we are. So we're going to try to mitigate against that. And I think that all teams have their own strengths and their own weaknesses. And to understand that, you know, when we hear, oh, no, the team that gets the most shot attempts is the most successful. No, that's not true. And understanding the different parts of analytics that need to be understood and applied. And I'm talking about within the team, and then we can explain it or try to outline it.
Well, I'll go next. I think for myself, guys, it's been more of helping to I think it just proves out a lot of things that instinctively as a player, you know, to be true, or also remove some of the biases that you've built over the years. And I really find that with maybe players I've played against, or maybe certain players you just, whatever, whether you like them or don't like them, you realize, oh, maybe, geez, he actually is good at breaking the puck out, you know, and maybe that one time I saw him get roasted by, you know, Crosby, and you think he's bad defensively, and then you realize, geez, he's actually really good. He's top 10 in the league of actually breaking the puck out. So I really found that, like I said, it proved a lot of the things that I just knew inherently, and then also helped me remove a lot of biases from things that I just developed over the years.
Yeah, and for me, it's been a fun process. It started out as I would watch the game and I would have a certain view and I would really lean on to say, am I going crazy? Is this really happening? Are they that porous defensively? How many rush chances have they allowed? And then when the data is there to support, like you're saying, Bryce, that's the main way I was using the analytics and having it support what I was seeing. And then came a different view as the analytics would come first. You know, Mike, you would suggest something or say something. And then it made me think, well, hold on a second. Let me take a look here. Yeah, the slot chances are ridiculous, and I never really noticed it. So it's been fun to see it from that perspective too, not just my own view of coming from a player's perspective and having the data support it. Having it come from the other angle has been insightful and part of the learning process for me, as far as, you know, understanding how the analytics plays into things and how those tendencies continue to repeat themselves. And I really think that that's the way the game's going. And as much as we like to, you know, I think you're right on the head, Craig. You talk about a team winning the cup and you think back to the Blues and the way they played. Everyone said they weren't fast enough. They were too slow. You know, all these things that were negative, they stayed to their identity. They're hard to play against. They're hard against the wall. And then in doing an analysis in preparation for playing against them, it was awesome to have the analytics to support things where I would say to Mike, okay, Mike, what, you know, it seems like every time they dump the puck in, they get it back. Like, they're so good on the walls. What are they doing? Well, actually, this is what their numbers are for retrievals on dumps. They dump it in more than everybody else, but they also get it back more than anybody else. So the analytics, once again, supports your analysis, and it's been an interesting process and learning through the different numbers that are out there, the different analysis that can be done to help support and make you more insightful and help. And really, we all don't want to remain stagnant. We want to grow as an analysis and offer more insight to the viewer and become better. So it's been a fun journey, and adding that in, not being afraid of the numbers, I think it is important, and that's where I think it's all going. And if you're afraid of it, you're probably going to be left behind. So I'm glad we jumped on board, at the beginning, a relative beginning.
But just think, Jam, we never had that even available to talk about before. Yeah. Like, of course it's going to evolve. Like, and if, yeah, like, we didn't even have a number to even try to refer to. And now we got like all this information, and it's like, how do we make it best? And so I'm sure the way you do, well, you've already touched on it, Sal did too, but like the way you started doing it, and then a couple of years later, you're like, you're doing it different because you're learning to do it differently. Like, I started with virtually no numbers. When I started broadcasting in 2002, like, man, we didn't have anything. We had shots on goal. And if somebody had the number of man advantage breaks, that was like gold, right? And and now it's like, this is, like, I think it makes it way more fun when a cool graphic comes up with really cool information. I'm like, I love that stuff. I think it really, it really makes the broadcast better.
I'm just going to share a quick story. I don't know if any of you have read Ken Dryden's book, Scotty, about Scotty Bowman. But Scotty was a Sherwin-Williams paint salesman in Montreal. So he used to go over, he was working for the Canadians part-time. Anyway, every Friday, he would go, the other one skating, and sit with Toe Blake. And Toe Blake, Scotty tells the story where Toe Blake had all the score sheets out and was looking at the at what was happening. And he said, there's a lot of things that are happening that my eyes aren't seeing. And he was doing analytics back in the 50s and 60s in a very, very elementary way. But he was doing it. And there was a situation where they couldn't beat Detroit. And he said to Scotty, your buddy Terry Harper's not playing tomorrow night. I analyzed the data. He's our problem. He's on the ice too much, right? But, like, it's evolution. But, you know, coaches that have – I mean, obviously, I mean, he had a different interest. He had time on his hands. But that's what it is. It's evolution. And but he knew that there was things that he wasn't seeing that told a bigger story. And I think that we have a great opportunity with analytics and Sportlogiq, what they provide us, to not have to go and look at all the score sheets and do it and try to figure it out. You know, so it really is an unbelievable tool in so many areas that really tell a story. And Mike, to go back to what you said, try to complete the picture.
Hey, Mike, my Ken Dryden mask on for that story behind me.
I can just add one thing there to what everyone's saying. Like, you know, you hear, you know, everyone talk about the evolution. And I also look at it as from the perspective of, we have a responsibility to help the game grow by educating the fans. And like Jammer said, you know, whether we're embracing this or being the first to really embrace it, to bring in and trying all different ways to present it. And some of it's good, some of it's bad. But, and then to what Ray was saying, like, you can't just say, oh, shots on goal anymore, right? Like, oh, they had, you know, 32 shots. I think you have to go a little bit deeper, you know, step by step, and to bring the fan along. And, you know, whether it be, the, you know, the Devils had a very strong penalty kill last season. And it's, to me, I've moved on from saying, oh, they're fifth ranked, best. Well, no, you know, I'd go in and part of the stats I would say was, hey, you know, they're the time, possession zone time in the defensive zone against them is the 29th lowest, right? Teams just don't have the offensive zone time on the penalty kill, all right? I would say their turnover rate, their ability to take the puck away from the other, from the power play is fourth best. So it's no longer just giving the fans, hey, their penalty kills fifth best in the National Hockey League. So I think it's a responsibility for us to provide some of those more reinforcing statements and facts.
Hey, Bryce, I'm just going to tag on to that. And it becomes even more important for us now. We don't know how many fans are coming back into the building. And, you know, we also have a responsibility now to make sure that the fans tuning in at home that may not have, and try to get them, you know, engaged in a different way. So I love that perspective about we have a responsibility, because we do.
Yeah, I think as well, if you talk to people that produce hockey games, I think all of us, it's building a connection with the viewer is paramount, right? That's what it's all about. The more connected a viewer is to the game that's going to be on the air, more likely they are to watch it and be involved, the pregame show, postgame, whatever. There are great ways to do that. You know, TSN does a good job. Hockey Night does a good job. A lot of broadcasters do, of telling great human interest stories. And now all of a sudden, even a casual fan who may not really care about what's happening in the game, if they've seen a great human interest story on Sidney Crosby, they're probably more inclined to be interested in, oh, maybe I'll watch some of this game. You can do the same thing with numbers and information. The more connected the viewer is to the understanding of the game, oh, this team plays this way, or I should watch for this thing. And then it happens, because as you guys all talk about repeatability, then they say, oh, I knew that was going to happen. I heard about that. They're more connected. So I think analytics can serve in the same way as something which is totally different, which would be a great human interest story. It's the same idea of connecting the person, the viewer, the consumer, to what you're presenting. So I think that's another, you know, effective use of it, I guess. And, you know, Kyle, I like what you said as well about that example of William Nylander and maybe not understanding or knowing just how much he was doing this thing that was, you know, leading to more goals for him. He was a guy who maybe been pegged a little bit as a perimeter player. So I think there's two truths there, which is, number one,
yeah, he has gone to that net front area where a lot of goals happen more this past season than he ever has before. So he's become less of a perimeter player in that way. But number two, he started doing this at an incredibly high rate, like top 10 in the league. And it's not about standing there and taking a beating. It's about weaving in and out at the right times, which is what you see more now. Where I think that the numbers can help with that is eventually you're going to pick that up with your eyes. But you can get there so much faster when you've got the data, right? Instead of having to watch 10 games and start to see it evolve, you can notice it after 2-3 games and then track it. And that's where I think that it can help as well as a storytelling tool, just to get you kind of, you know, there faster than maybe you've been able to get there before.
Yeah, just like with, as I mentioned earlier, the trends, right, over the course of a game, mm-hmm. or over the course of a couple games. And that's certainly, as I said, the insights and the stuff that you send to us opens my eyes in terms of, oh man, yeah, there's data there, obviously, that's showing there's precedence for what this player or this team is doing. And then you kind of watch it a little bit more. And you can only imagine how many different fans or viewers are sitting there at home, and now all of a sudden Ray's making a point on odd man rushes and how good a team is or how poor a team is and giving it up. And they're sitting there going like, yeah, I've been telling my buddy that for weeks. That's what I thought I was seeing. And yeah. So there's that connection there with the viewer that we were talking to. So all of that, I think, plays a big role in the connection between us as broadcasters to tell the story to those who, of course, are tuning in every night.
You know, it's funny how a couple of threads keep coming back. You know, Kyle, you're talking about setting up a story at the start of the game and then something happens. Jamal was mentioning earlier about repeatable things. And then we start talking about Nylander getting to the front of the net. If I were to think of something that happens more predictably in the NHL in goal scoring, it would be Ovechkin scoring from the left circle on the one-timer, right? So I was shocked this year when I saw the numbers of how many goals he gets close to the net. Like, I don't know. I think he scores every goal from the left faceoff. and then you look at it and you're like, oh my gosh, like there was a high percentage of goals that he was getting in, like on that left side, but right down to the goal line. And even something as predictable as an Ovechkin goal, you can present as unpredictable because the numbers now will show us that that's what's happening. And that can be set up in the pregame. Mm-hmm. I can touch on it in the game. Bryce and Jam can talk about it in between periods. It's all a thread of analytics that can go all the way through the game on a particular play or player or scenario. I think that has changed and will continue to change.
What I'm interested in, I think most kids, they watch the games, they watch sports with their device.
Mm. Yeah.
So what I'm interested in is, how is that going to change things in the analytics field? Are you able to provide them information to their device, even a further deep dive in, maybe build upon what we talked about, and maybe it's part of the different networks app application, but they're watching it, they're watching the game, they're hearing what Ray's saying, They like what he said. They want to get a deeper dive into that analytics. Boom, they click on their device. Now they're going even further into it and maybe even seeing video clips of past examples because as we talked about, things happen over and over again. That's where I see it going because my kids, they watch, they're doing five things at once while they're watching a game. I don't know how they do it, but, you know, so I think that's how they're going to take their information. They want to hear what we're saying. Then they want to do their own little dive into it. Get some more information. So kind of that's where I see it going.
Since I get certainly like the generation coming up, like it's tougher and tougher for them to sit down for 2.5 hours and watch a game. And so we get all this great information. Our font and graphics people put together a beautiful, gorgeous looking piece that Ray can break down or Bryce or Jamal or Craig. And it's 10 seconds and then it's gone, right? Like it's up and evaporated. So I would love to see, you know, whether it's through, you know, TSN Twitter feeds or Sportsnet or whoever, or their Instagram stuff on their story. Like, is there a way that you can grab those little segments that properly help tell the story of the game that's unfolding that night? And can it be posted elsewhere where the kids that are there sitting there scrolling through on the couch or wherever they are, get that little nugget of information to kind of go, oh, that's kind of interesting. Because as I say, like there's a lot of people that put some good work into all this information. And of course, those that ultimately present it on air. And you just hate for, you know, sometimes when you put in all that together and within 10 seconds, it's up and vanished. So just have a little bit more. I understand certain things only have a certain lifespan, but to create a couple little more opportunities to be able to get some eyeballs on it and have a better understanding and education with what a player is doing or how a game's unfolding, that could be a big help, I think, too.
Yeah, Mike, one thing I would also add to this, too, is that, you know, when I also think about the fans, I also think about our producers, our people in leadership positions. You know, how do we give them examples of how this is going to be better for not just the production and to Jamal's point there about multiple devices, like to the networks. Yeah. I mean, we work for telcos, right? Like, so, you know, how do they deliver these things to different devices, and how do we convince them that, you know, how we tell these stories and the manner in which we tell them, right? I mean, Kyle, you know, with Rogers and TSM with Bell, I mean, it's all about the phone, right? It's all about the devices. So how do we demonstrate to our leaders, the people in positions of power and that make these decisions, that this is a path to go down as well?
We'll let you go on this one, just because I'm curious hearing what you guys have to say. Different time now. Let's assume hockey does come back, you know, late July, and we get the play-ins and the playoffs and all that, likely with no fans in buildings, only in a couple of venues. The broadcasts themselves will be very different. Analytics being a part of this, yes, but just even in general, how do you see these broadcasts being different from what fans are used to, and what are some recommendations you might have to, you know, kind of make up for what we'll be missing because of the different circumstances?
Well, I think they'll be different in a couple of ways, but I think there'll be access of cameras that couldn't be used in other times because there's going to be people in the seats. I mean, the networks are able to string a camera almost anywhere in the building, right? Because they can run it right through the middle of the stands. There's going to be nobody there. That might give you a different perspective. There'll certainly be some audio that, that you'll hear that you wouldn't hear before. And I know we're all concerned about, we're going to hear stuff that we don't maybe necessarily want to hear. I don't know if you guys watch golf or not, but Rory McIlroy buried one behind the tree way out right, and he dropped an F-bomb, and Nick Faldo said that's the technical term for pushing it out to the right. You know, like he had to cover it up. But what we're going to hear, you're going to hear the actual, you know, the sound of the puck hitting the stick, the skates as they dig in, the contact. Sometimes, like, you know, when Sal and I are standing down there between the benches, and you know, unfortunately, we've been on the receiving end of it too. When you hear guys crunch together, like sometimes it sounds like a car crash, and like you're going to hear all of those things. The game's still going to be the game, whether there's people in the building or not, and there's still going to be a premium on the time that you're going to have to put information into the game. So I think that'll stay similar, but to me, it's some audio. It's some visual that will be different. It certainly won't, it won't look completely different, but I think it'll look a little bit different for sure.
I just hope the mindset shifts from, you know, it's going to be different. Like, we may not be able to do things the way we normally would. There's not going to be the same atmosphere. Maybe our commentators aren't able to be in the building to actually call the game on site right away, to how do we make the most out of what we have? How do we be better when we come back versus where we left it? You know, Ray touched on some of the different things we'll be able to do because of it technically in terms of cameras and audio and all of that. And then on top of that, what are the different type of creative storytelling we can do? And of course, you're committed or you're restrained to certain times that you're able to get it in. The different information that we can incorporate, again, that you're not overloading the viewer, but what makes sense at a given time, and just finding ways to enhance the overall experience. Like, I can't foresee another situation where all eyes are going to be on a sport eagerly anticipating its return in a situation like we're going to have here this summer, if they're able to return to play. So whoever is the one broadcasting the games, I mean, you just hope that the mindset is about how do we get the most out of this rather than worrying about all the other things that we were used to having that maybe we won't initially for the return.
Yeah, I think that, you know, there's opportunity here to try to do some different things, but I also think you have to be careful about, you know, not just experimenting for experimenting sakes, you know, what makes sense. And, you know, I think another big part of what has to happen, and we've seen collaboration to this point between the NHL and the Players Association, is the players have to get invested in this, and they have to be allowed to be part of this too. Now, I'm not saying we mic them up or anything, but, you know, let them be free in terms of talking how different it is playing with no fans and the different challenges, and tell those stories, and let's let it be real, and let's take the viewers into this space that, quite frankly, none of us have ever seen. I mean, this is an unprecedented time. So I think among those things, I mean, the data, how the broadcast is presented, and let's not be afraid to try a few different things. And I'm all open for that, but make sure that it's something that we're doing that, I guess I would say, not gimmicky. Let's try things that we've thought about for a period of time and then move forward from that. But I think the players also have a great opportunity to be a big part of this. I mean, we know through their play they're going to be a big part of it, but their feelings and how it's been. And after 2 weeks, Kyle, you're talking to a player and going, okay, 2 weeks, how does this feel being, you know, we have to be able to ask those questions, and the players, we have to allow the players to be honest about them and be forthright.
Yeah, my hope is that there's an increase in the access. And you talked about getting some microphones on the players and the coaches. We've done that, but maybe even take fans even further behind the scenes in the preparation. Certainly not the details of their PP meeting or their PK meeting, but I think giving fans an understanding of what players' day looks like and giving them a background of how it may have changed or differs from what it was before. And, you know, letting people inside access maybe they wouldn't have had before. Hopefully the players are part of that process, because I certainly believe and agree with you, Craig, that they have to be. And but I absolutely look at it as an opportunity to try some things and to think outside the box and really, you know, get fans as close as possible, with the understanding you are going to hear a few it's going to happen, and you just have to be as skilled and as gifted the gab as Ray is to make sure you can talk over it and laugh about it. So I think it's an opportunity. I'm excited. I think everyone in the sports world is starving for some normalcy, and hopefully hockey can give them that. And it'll be also interesting to show the fans, as important as they are, and I think it'll be interesting how this is communicated. It's going to take 2 or 3 games probably for the players to adjust to no fans, but the intensity, the rivalry, the ferocity that they play the game with will still be there. And it'll be interesting to talk about that with the players and talk about how that's still able to happen without fans. I think that's an interesting dynamic that people really start to understand how dialed in, how invested, how focused these players are in these moments to compete for a cup.
Yeah, well, Jamal, that's exactly where I was going, was your last comment there. And Ray, you can attest to this. Like, what I tell people is that when you're in between the benches and right there, like, the energy from the fans and everything else, it's hard to explain. It has an impact. And so to your point, Jamal, it's going to be interesting to see how long it takes them for them to adjust to maybe not having that. Because as players, we know how to tune it out. We understand that it's there, but it also is energy that we all, you know, would receive and play off of. So I'm really interested to see how the players, and to, you know, to Kyle and everyone's point, how they talk about it and just what happens there. But I just hope that the focus is on opportunity. It's not nitpicking things that are different, because it is going to be different. Let's if we're going to nitpick things, it's nitpick, geez, how could we have done that better? And really just bring the fans along in a positive environment and just be focused on moving forward and making the game great. And, you know, and tying into what Jamal and Craig and Kyle, everyone said, and Mike, you know, you and I have even talked about, how do you have the game live on, right, with some of those different videos where you know, this is an opportunity. You're going to have fans focused on the game and watching it. So if the commentators are talking about the inner slot, to what everyone said, well, geez, I want to push a button and say, okay, what is the inner slot? And the video that you know, we've been talking about, Mike, it pops up and it explains that, right? Because there's an opportunity here to educate the fans in some of these new terms that we're all trying to grow and include into the game. Zone entry, you know, face off, you know, I would say rebounds off of a win or off a shot attempt. And just all these different terms that we are all trying to introduce here from analytics. I think this is an opportunity to educate the fans on their own time while they're watching the game.
Awesome. The Pat Kane, Austin Matthews goal, Selly, will have a little different meaning when there's literally no fans in the building.
That's right.
But we'll see what those Sellies are like now that the players don't have fans there. But look, guys, this has been awesome. Like I said, I could do this for a lot longer, but I don't want to take up too much of your time. So I have a TV to install on my wall at home too. So there's probably going to be a screw through the middle of my hand in about an hour. But thanks a lot for coming on. And you know, it's great to see how you guys have been able to take a different kind of information and include it into the work that you guys do. I think it speaks to you guys are among the best at what you do, and you still want to find ways to grow and evolve. So as you guys all know, I could talk hockey with you guys forever, but we'll let you go. So thanks a lot for coming on, and hopefully we've got games to talk about before too long.